Thank you. I'll continue with the last topic, which is the electron force microscopy. In last class we talked about the atomic force microscopy, and then we'll just talk about the various types of the atomic force microscopy. This is the last thing which we discussed in the class. It's the AFM, atomic force microscopy, and then we'll talk about the different instruments which are based on the same principle. With the type of force, we'll try to understand how an AFM, FMM, or MFM, STM works on the same principle of atomic force microscopy. Whenever we talk about the atomic force microscopy, it is simply when the cantilever or the microscopy measurements are done on the basis of the force between the tip and the sample. So I'll just continue with the electrostatic force microscopy and then some other techniques of the microscopic techniques. The first one is the electron force microscopy. As it is very clear from the name that in case of electron force microscopy, the electric means the force exerted between the sample and tip is the electric force. And when we talk about electrostatic force, it is simply either a Coulombic repulsion or Coulombic attraction forces. So, in case of electrostatic force microscopy, AFM is used to make the vertical and near vertical gradient of the electric field between the tip and sample versus the in-plane coordinate x and y. It's just like this tip is moving in this direction on the xy plane. This is done using the lift mod. The field due to trapped charges on or beneath the sample surface is often sufficiently large to generate the contrast in an EFM image. EFM image stands for the electric force microscopic image. Otherwise, the field can be reduced by applying a voltage between the tip and sample. If there is no sufficient forces between the or no sufficient electric field is generated between the force and sample and tip, then we will give the voltage from external, and that the voltage may be applied directly from the microscopic's electronic under AFM software control or from the external power supply with the appropriate current limiting element in the place. So it's very easy to understand that simply the measuring the electric field behavior or measuring the electrostatic force between the tip and sample, we can analyze the image, or we can form the image of the sample as well as the topographic image, which gives them more information about the sample. Or by applying the external voltage, we try to understand how it behaves with the external force. In this case, well, there are three modes. The most important one is the amplitude detection, phase detection, or the frequency modulation. These are different modes used for the EFM. The major applications of EFM are the electrical failure analysis, detecting trapped charges, or mapping electric polarization, and the last one, which is very important, and performing electrical read write among other applications. Now, when we talk about the interaction between the two charges, maybe attractive or repulsive, this is the magnitude of the force, how it varies from one place to another. If you look on the bottommost, it is the Coulombic force, which is the repulsive force, which is in the order of 10 to the minus 10 meter distance. The other one, if the tip and sample distance is increased by a slide, then there is an attraction force exerted on the sample and tip, which is the van der Waals attractive forces, and then we'll talk about the fluid surface tension and the electrostatic force or the some other forces. Now, what is the working principle of EFM or say FM? This is the easiest way to understand the working principle of EFM. This is the piezoelectric material, this is the sample, and these are the conductive domain. Same we can understand in case of magnetic domain. So here either electric or magnetic domains are present. If the magnetic domains are present and the sample tip is magnetic, then we say it is the magnetic force microscope, otherwise it is the electrostatic force microscope. Now, when we look on this diagram, the first one, cantilever measures surface topography on first scan. We just go to the first scan of the sample so that we will get the idea about the topographic scale, or we just got the idea about the behavior of the sample in the measure portion. Now, after that, we will move it to the original position, and then cantilever ascends to lift skin height. We need to look for the at what height this skin is performed. Maybe it is at the touching mode or maybe non-contact mode, or maybe in case of tapping mode also. So it is moved to slight height and then it again scan the surface and try to take observation of the sample. So the second one is here, after tomographic scan, the tip is lifted up from some height and it scanned the surface from the side, and we got this image which is known as the cantilever photo, stored surface topography at the lift height above sample while responding to electric influence on the second interview scheme. So ultimately we need to understand the first one, the topographic scan data gives the idea about the presence of the electric domains and all conductive domains, and then we go for the interview scan or electric scope data which gives the more information about these tips. These positions are explained by the electric scope data. Now this is the easiest way to understand that what is happening in case of electric force microscope or magnetic force microscope or any atomic force microscope. When the cantilever bends toward the sample, there is a tension, there is an attractive force exerted on the sample, and in result there is a shift in the frequency. This is the original frequency, which is known as natural frequency. Even in atomic force microscope, we discussed about the change in frequency due to the forces exerted between the sample and tip, or say tip and sample forces. So in case of attraction, there is a bending, and in result the natural frequency is delta F naught, and there is a decrease in the frequency. Whereas in case of repulsive forces or repulsive gradient forces, there is a change in the, or there is an increase in the frequency of the oscillation. So what is that actually happening in case of electric force microscopy? In this manner, the cantilever is vibrated by a small piezoelectric element near its resonant frequency. Again, there is the F naught or omega naught or mu naught. The cantilever's resonant frequency changes in response to any additional force gradient. If there is an attractive or repulsive force, in that case, the cantilever may attract or repel, or what you say, it is a cantilever effectively moving towards the sample or away from that. If it is moving towards the sample, it means there is an attractive force which makes it softer, means the frequency decreases. And if it is repelled by the sample, then in that case it is the stiffer, or so the frequency, resonant frequency is shifted to some higher values. So what is the meaning of this electric force microscopy, or how to understand in a shortest way? The first one, the mechanical vibration is given to the tip so that it just scans the surface of the sample. Electric field will produce a change in phase of tip. Third one is the basal field is like relative to piezoelectric signal. When we talk about atomic force microscopy, if any signal or any deviation observed from the laser beam, then it is measured by the scanner, and it gives the idea about what is the phase length or the deviation occurred in the force piezoelectric material. In most cases, it is necessary to apply a voltage across the tip or sample to achieve a high quality image. The external applied voltage is important or say necessary to get the best quality image, because the voltage generated between the sample and tip is very small. Now, even if a layer of insulating material covered the conducting domain, they still can be detected by this electric force microscopy. Now, this is another way to understand that if these domains are present in case of magnetic force microscope, then these are the magnetic domains which can be analyzed by the sample. Now this is the rough diagram of the electric force microscopy or surface detection technique used for the EFM. This is the most important part. We will not talk about the electric part or the electronic circuitry, but this is the most important one. This is the sample, this is the piece of material which is having tapping property, means it can be moved up and down, and this is the laser beam, which is, and in case of no electrostatic force, it is having some particular position which is deviated or changed whenever an electrostatic force exerted between tip and sample. Now how to compare the phase imaging and the phase image in the EFM? During phase imaging, in case of transmission electron microscope or scanning probe microscopy, tapping mode imaging, the tip is tapping in the surface, and the phase change due to the van der Waals force gradient of the sample, means this is due to the repulsive force exerted or attractive force exerted between two materials. Whereas in case of phase image of EFM, electric force microscope, the non-contact techniques, phase image are obtained in lift mode, and the phase change results from electrostatic force gradient, which is the basic principle of atomic force microscopy, that the change in different gradient or change in the force gradient is responsible for any change observed in the image of the sample. The another technique, which is also based on the principle of AFM, is known as dynamic force microscopy. In this case, in DFM, the cantilever oscillates and touches the sample only intermediately at the end of its downward moment. Means it is in the tapping mode, just like it is moving. This is the tapping mode. And due to this tapping mode, we just get the information momentary end. The best part of this, the sample is never damaged due to the tapping of this, the tip of the sample. So, which reduces the contact time and minimizes friction forces, amplitude, phase or resonance shifts of the cantilever oscillations of including sample interactions are measured in the dynamic force microscopy. DFM is proven to be 4 order of magnitude more sensitive than contact mode AFM in detecting long-range effective forces. This is the beauty of the DFM, that in case of tapping mode AFM, we just get the more information in the DFM, which is having approximately 4 order, means around 1000 or 10,000 times better than the contact mode AFM, which is used earlier in the previous class. Imaging of pyrophosphate sample has therefore greatly benefited from the development of DFM. Soft samples are significantly less deformed and cross weakly error to the surface. As I said in the earlier part, in case of dynamic force microscopy, the beauty of tapping mode is the biological sample or even the soft samples are never damaged using the tapping mode sample. Whereas in case of contact mode, there are chances of the damage of the sample and in result will not get the proper information. In order to prevent large latent forces applied during contact mode, various dynamical operational modes were successfully introduced. In case of DFM, there are a number of modes used to understand the motion of the or the to know the properties of sample. When working in these dynamical modes, the cantilever is oscillated in the z direction at its resonant frequency or near resonance frequency. Again, as I say, that it is oscillating in the z direction and scaling the xy plane of the sample, and in result look at the image of the xy plane of the sample. Because the oscillating tube touches the sample and it reaches the lowest point, this imaging mode is now called the tipping mode. Hence, this is the oscillating one, and at every end of the tip, end of every oscillation, it touches the sample, and in result takes the information from that sample. Therefore, the tip is only in intermediate contact with the sample and applied shear forces are often negligible. This, the shear forces which may affect the sample or tip are almost negligible, and we just got the information which is a commentary, and for every point we get a complete information. Under optimum conditions, the resolution has been demonstrated to be as low as 0.5 nanometer, which is one of the best in the microscopic techniques, in the XY plane and approximately 1 angstrom in the Z direction. A recent development also allows the tracking of biomolecules at relatively high speed in a body or in a part of the sample. If any sample biomolecule is injected, then it is possible to track the path of biomolecule in the given sample, and that gives the information that how a biomolecule can move in a body or in any tissue or cell. In short, how can we define the complete dynamic force microscopy? And this is the best way. This is the tip. When in the tapping mode, it touches like this. So these are the oscillations, and it's touching the surface and giving the information, or the forming an image which gives the information about the sample. So, what is the DFM? It is oscillating cantilever tip touching surface gently and frequently, often used for the biological sample. As I said, in this case, DFM, the damage of biological sample is this, and because of that reason, it is used for the biological sample. Imaging in the air and liquid, there are some samples which may not exist in the air or maybe in the some solid mode, so it is easier to use them in the liquid. So this DFM gives us that facility to take the observations even in the liquid form. And the last one is that its resolution is good as good as say 0.5 nanometer in the XY plane. Next one is the scanning thermal microscopy. Now, as I started today, everything is based on the atomic force microscopy. We are looking for the older techniques which is having the principle of atomic force microscope. Whereas, as I changed the name of the microscopy, the only working principle changed in terms of the force between the tip and sample, and how that force is changed is given the name of the microscopy. Like here, it is very clear to understand by the name only, staining thermal microscopy. Thermal microscopy means I am trying to look something which is having property of conduction or so the change in temperature. So by measuring the conductive property or change in temperature or the heat transfer, I can identify the sample or knows about the, some of the properties of the sample. So what is the staining thermal microscopy? STHM is a secondary imaging mode derived from contact AFM only that maps two-dimensional temperature variation across the sample surface. So it is simply staining on the two-dimensional surface of the sample and gives the information about it. As with the many other modes, STHM allows simultaneous acquisition of topographic data. At the heart of an STHM system is a thermal probe with a resistive element. This is the beauty of the system, that in last case, dynamic force microscopy or electric force microscopy we are using either electric, magnetic or another type of tip, whereas in this case we are having a thermal probe which is basically made up of either platinum, iridium or any thermocouple which measure even a very small change in the temperature or heat transfer. A thermal control unit carries out thermal reading and control to produce images based on the variation in either sample temperature or thermal conductivity. So it can measure the temperature or the thermal conductivity, which gives the idea about how the heat is from sample tip or tip to sample. Common applications include semiconductor failure analysis, material distribution in the composites and magnetoresistive hair characterizations. These are the important applications of the scanning thermal microscopy. In case of scanning thermal microscopy, we use a different type of cantilevers are available for STHM. The cantilever can be composed of two different metal or it can have thermal alignment made up of two metal bars. So as I said, this composed of two metals, maybe platinum, iridium or any other composition, or we say it is a thermal element made up of two metal bars. So anything is possible, like thermocouple, iron copper or nickel chrome, any thermocouple is used in the tip material. The material of the cantilever responds differently to change in the thermal conductivity, causing the cantilever to deflect. And the system uses the change in cantilever deflection to generate an STHM image and remove thermal conductivity. It is exactly what I said in case of the AFM. Whenever a sample scans the surface, there is a beam drawn from a source, that is the laser source, and any change occurred or any deflection observed in the that cantilever is observed by the change in the path of the laser, and by measuring the deviation in the laser beam you can identify the properties of the material. A topographic image can be generated from the changes in the cantilever's amplitude of vibrations. This is very clear from here that the vibrations are changed when it scans the surface, and in result we can get the topographic image of the sample. Thus, topographic information can be separated from local variations in the sample's thermal properties, and the two types of images can be collected simultaneously. That means topographic image or thermal image can be obtained from the sample. This is what the simplest diagram to understand the scanning thermal microscopy. This is the tip, this is the sample, and this is the cantilever mount where cantilever is mounted, and this is the laser beam. So whatever change observed in scanning of the surface, the laser reflects its path and that is detected by the photo detector to get the information about the sample surface. These are the images obtained for the scanning thermal microscopy and taken from the simultaneous acquisition of topography and thermal data. Another type of thermal cantilever uses a Wollaston wire as the probe. So this is another type of probe which is used in the thermal scanning microscopy. As the probe which incorporates resistive thermal element at the end of the cantilever. The arm of the cantilever are made up of silver wire. The resistive element at the end which forms the thermal probe is made from platinum or platinum 10% rhodium alloy. So these are the basically alloys used for the probe preparation, maybe platinum, iridium, maybe platinum, rhodium or some other alloys are also possible to use. This design has the advantage of being capable of thermal imaging of either sample temperature or thermal conductivity of the sample. There are some applications of STHM. It is mainly used to take the skin image or topographic image of the sample and the thermal properties of thermal conductivity. Ultra large scale integration lithography detecting phase change in the polymer bands, Joule's heating effect or basic material conditions and semiconductor basis and number of the applications which are used in terms of the scanning thermal microscopy. These can be detected by scanning thermal microscopy. Another one is the piezo force microscopy. Now the word piezo means what? Whenever we talk about a piezo word, it is very clear in our mind that a material which changes electrical energy to mechanical or mechanical to electrical energy, and the conversion of energy is easily observed by the piezoelectric materials. Whenever we talk about a piezo force microscopy, this tip is of piezo material and rest of the principles are exactly same. Means we will not talk about anything different from the principle of AFM. The only thing which is changed in the every type of the microscopy is the probe, and the interaction between probe and sample is different, and those interactions are measured by the same technique which is the laser division or bending in the cantilever. From the first day scanning probe microscopy is introduced to the contemporary research 20 years, new modes and applications have emerged with the unprecedented speed. Along this versatile tool to look into the ever increasing aspect of local material properties at the nanometer scale. As we know about the nanomaterials or nanotechnology, the beauty of nano is it is used to produce new type of materials or new sample. And when we talk about the new materials or new sample, we need to look for the new properties which are originated with the mixing or the production of new materials. So how the properties can be measured? Like if I talk about the electric, we make a new sample and it is having good electric property, then we need to look for the electric property by what? Then electric force microscopy gives us information about the sample and their electric properties. Similarly, for the magnetic properties or dynamic properties and even piezo properties of the given material. So in case of piezo force microscopy, we use novel mode simply the piezo forces are responsible to change or to deviate or to get the reflection in the cantilever. Piezoelectric force microscopy is one of such a novel mode which has gained increasing recognition through recent years for the unique information it can offer on the electromechanical coupling characteristics of various ferroelectric, piezoelectric polymer or biological materials. In PFM operation, a conductive AFM tip is brought into contact with the surface of the stated ferroelectric or piezoelectric materials, and a preset voltage is applied between the sample surface and the AFM tip, establishing an external electric field within the sample. This para is the most important one, which gives the complete idea about the working of piezo microscopy. That in PFM operation, a conductive AFM tip is brought into contact with the surface of studied ferroelectric or piezoelectric material. So we have this tip and there is a sample where it is in contact. Now as we apply the preset, applies voltage between the tip and sample surface. In result, an external electric field is generated, and due to the external electric field there is change in the shape, or maybe there is some vibrations are produced in the sample, and those will affect the position of the tip, and in result we got the magnitude of the piezo force exerted on the tip. Due to the electrostriction or even inverse piezoelectric effect of such ferroelectric or piezoelectric materials, the sample would locally expand or contract according to the electric field. This is, as I said, the change in the material, change in the shape of that, and it starts to oscillate or produce some mechanical waves or acoustic waves. For example, if the initial polarization of electrical domain of the desert sample is perpendicular to the sample surface, and parallel to the applied electric field, the domain would experience vertical expansion. Means if the external the polarization is in the direction of electrical domain, and if the forces are parallel, then in that case there is an expansion, or vice versa, it may be in contraction also. Conversely, if the initial domain polarization is anti-parallel, means started with the anti-parallel, that I will show with the diagram also, to the applied electric field, the domain would contract and in turn result a decreased cantilever deflection. In first case, the deflection increased or the deviation increased in case of the parallel, and in case of anti-parallel domain of polarization and electric field, we will get the contraction in the cantilever. The amount of cantilever deflection change in such situation is directly related to the amount of expansion or contraction of the sample. Electric domains enhance proportional to the applied electric field. So whatever field is applied from external is giving the change in the magnitude of the contraction and expansion of the cantilever. This is what the diagram shows everything about the phase of force microscopy. Here air gun mode, probe with the initial deflection arc, and this is the parallactic domain. And these two are parallel, this and external one, we got the convection in the tip, whereas in this case, we got the expansion in the tip. If the applied voltage contains a small AC component, the inverse piezoelectric response from the sample would result in sample surface oscillations in the same frequency as the applied AC voltage. In the case that the sample is an ideal piezoelectric crystal, its polarization would be related to the applied mechanical stress by the following equation. So, simply if the external voltage may contain some AC, so AC signal, then it is the cantilever or the sample start to oscillate with the external frequency, and in result, we get the same mechanical stress is observed in the sample, and that can be measured by these equations. No need to look for these equations. This is how the sample can be behaved. When we say the voltage and time graph is plotted for the behavior of the local polarization and the external field, then this is the external field, and this is what we see, the piezoelectric response obtained for the sample. These are in opposite phase. So in typical piezoelectric force imaging, the applied AC voltage is said to be much lower than the coaxial bias for the sample domain switching, so that they cannot switch from one another, to avoid alteration of the local domain structure of the static sample. If such criteria is met, the phase contrast generated in the PFM imaging would reflect the domain polarity in different sample locations. While from the magnitude of the amplitude signal, local piezoelectric coefficient of sample can be extracted, and this gives the information about the sample and its imaging. Another some examples are given for the piezo force microscopy, which we can read over here. This is the figures, or these are the plots which are obtained for the piezo force microscopy. For more complicated sample domain orientations containing not only component perpendicular to the surface in contact with the air cavity, but also component along different directions within the surface plane, vector PFM with the one vertical and two lateral channels can provide more complete information. So simply we can take the information in one direction or two direction, or the movement in the parallel and anti-parallel directions. These are the some information taken from here, that vertical PFM amplitude is measured in this way. This is a phase, this is another amplitude, lateral, and this is the lateral PFM phase. So by this PFM microscopy or piezoelectric force microscopy, we can understand that the phase change or amplitude change can be easily obtained through the PFM, and that those will give the information about the sample. Now what are the applications of piezo force microscopy? The first one is the local characterization of electromechanical properties of the material, including detailed domain mapping and study of domain switching dynamics. So whenever we talk about the dynamics of the material, that can be characterized by the application of piezo force microscopy. And the most important one, the piezo force or reverse piezo force, means both the properties can be detected using piezo force microscopy. Testing of micro and nano electromechanical devices like piezoelectric actuators, transducers, MEMS, all are the electromechanical systems whose properties can be characterized using PFM. And the last one is exploring the local and global relationship between polarity and other material properties of novel polymer and other materials. The next one is the scanning capacitance microscopy. Again, exactly same principle of electric force microscopy here. Local field is produced, or local field is oriented between the tip and sample, and due to that sample, there is a capacitance is generated, and by using that capacitance, we can understand the topography or the properties of the material. The scanning capacitance microscopy is a variety of scanning probe microscopy in which a narrow probe electrode is held just above the surface of a sample and scanned across the sample. So this is not in contact, it is in the non-contact mode of the microscopy, where it is just on the surface and scanned thoroughly to the surface of the sample. STM characterizes the surface of the sample using information obtained from change in electrostatic capacitance between the surface and the probe. As I said, the scanning capacitance microscopy is based on the principle of the scanning of surface and the local electric field developed between the tip and sample. In result, the change in capacitance, and that capacitance change is measured by the probe. This is what the basic principle of scanning capacitance microscopy. SCMOS initially devised as a quality control tool for the RCA-CAD, that is a capacitance electronic disc, a video disc, DVD and all those. These are what you say characterized by the scanning capacitance microscopy. This is what the working principle of scanning capacitance microscopy, that by measuring the capacitance developed between the sample and in this we got the sample electrostatic circuit or electrical circuit and get the information about the sample and the behavior of the sample. These are the some more informations, like this is the metallic tip. This tip is in contact with the sample, sorry, non-contact mode in the sample and gives the information. This electronic devices will give you the information about the topographic image and scanning capacitance microscopic image of the sample. SCM uses the ultrasharp conducting probes of the platinum iridium or cobalt chromium metal coating and ash silicon foil to form a metal insulator semiconductor capacitor with a semiconductor sample if an active oxide is present. This is the beauty of the system, that it is forming a layer which is known as metal oxide semiconductor, and this will give the information about the sample, or this gives about the local capacitance produced between the two samples, which is tip and the sample. When no oxide is present, a Schottky capacitance is formed. When the probe and surface are in contact, an IC device is applied, generating capacitance variation in the sample, which can be detected using a GHz or resonant capacitance sensors. So, either in absence or presence of oxide, you can understand the behavior of the material. And if there is no oxide present, then we need to apply an external potential to get the information. The tip is then scanned across the semiconductor surface in 2D, while the tip's height is controlled by conventional contact forces feedback. By applying the alternating bias to the metal coated bulk carrier, alternately accumulated and deflated within the semiconductor surface layer, and which changes the tip sample capacitance, and that can be measured easily by the locking amplifiers and the electronic circuit tool. The magnitude of this change in the capacitance with the applied voltage gives information about the concentration of carriers. Remember, we are talking about semiconducting materials or conductive materials. Then, the most important information required for these type of samples is what type of carriers are present in the sample. Maybe p-type or n-type, maybe holes or electrons. So, in this case, by knowing the scanning capacitance microscopic image, we can identify the what type of carriers are present. Whereas the difference in phase between the capacitance change and applied alternating bias carriers information about the sign of the charge carrier. So, this is the beauty. In first case, by taking the amplitude, you just get an idea about the type of concentration of carriers, and by knowing the phase between the capacitance produced is the type of charge carrier, which is positive or negative. Because SCM functions even though an insulating carrier, a finite conductivity is not required to measure the electrical properties. Now these are the some informations. The first one is the oxide pattern, where we just got the information that these are the positions where the oxides are present. See, the first one is the topographic SCM image of semiconductor surface. The bright design in the topography base represents the thermally drawn silicon diode pattern or silicon dioxide is present. And here, if you look, these are some spots which shows the doping of the material. The bright circular and outer rectangular region, the SCM image are heavily doped by arsenic plus ion with the having 50 kilo electron volt energy and approximately 10^14 ions charge density. This is another image. Now, resolution of SCM. The most important parameter for any type of microscopies is what is its resolution. Like in case of the FM, we found that the resolution is approximately 0.5 nanometer, which is what you say is the best one to understand the topography of the samples. So, in case of scanning capacitance microscopy, it's estimated approximately 2 nanometer, but it is possible to achieve lower resolution also. For the high resolution, the quick analysis of capacitance of capacitor with rough electrode is required, and that is capable, that is possible to achieve. This SCM resolution is in order of magnitude better than that estimated for the atomic nanoscope. However, as another other kind of the probe microscopy, SCM requires carefully preparation of the analyzed surface, which is supposed to be almost flat. And as we discussed in the AFM also, the most important parameter for the all dipole scanning or probe microscopies is the sample progression. Here also the sample progression technique is very important. And the last one are the applications of scanning capacitance microscopy. Mapping the dopant profile in semiconductor device on a 10 nanometer scale. Now when we say doping, the doping is when we dope with the semiconducting material with this, some maybe positive or negative charge cases, or maybe some trivalent or pentavalent doping. In that case, it is possible to take the dopant profile of the material or dopant profile of the given semiconductor, which gives information about, which gives the complete information about the sample. Quantification of the local dielectric properties and hafnium based high K dielectric film brought by an atomic layer deposition method, or there are many applications of this technique. This is all about the all type of microscopy technique. And the next one is the nano indentation. Just I'll use a few words to explain the nano indentation. Mechanical probing of material surface to nanometer scale depth while simultaneously monitoring load and depth is known as nano indentation, and this is the technique which is used by the number of scientists to understand the stress or the mechanical properties observed for new materials, even the old materials, where we can find out the stress capability of the any sample using this technique, which is known as nano indentation. Here we are just looking what is the property of the material by going to depth of only few nanometers. Now why we are using this one? Material engineering, optimizing material compositions. By using this technique, we can identify the property of the material and we can improve the material composition to get the better properties in bulk as well in thin materials. Mechanics of small volume, understanding whether thin film, line, dot have different mechanical properties than bulk counterpart or not. By this technique, we can identify then how the mechanical properties are changing of a given material from bulk to nano or from micro to nano world. And the last one is material physicists who are looking always for the new techniques, new samples, which gives the better properties in terms of maybe electrical, magnetic, mechanical or any other type of properties. Measuring deformation processes such as dislocation, duplication, crack growth, etc. These can be identified by the nano indentation. This is all about the brief idea of the nano indentation, and next class we will talk about the